Good evening and welcome to the Springhill broadcast. We are excited to have you in worship with us tonight. No matter if you're joining us from somewhere else around the Gainesville region, somewhere else in the state of Florida, somewhere else in another part of the United States, or even around the globe, we are excited to have you in worship with us here tonight. Do us a favor, go ahead and hit like, a thumbs up, and subscribe on whatever platform you're on. And do know we have prayed for, planned for, and prepared for you to worship with us tonight. And we are praising God by the opportunity to be able to share in God's word. As a matter of fact, the Bible says, "This is the day that the Lord has made, and I will rejoice and be glad in it." No matter what you face today, no matter what you've gone through, do know that this is the day the Lord has made. So if it was a great day, He knew it was going to be great. If it was a not so great day, He still knew about all of the challenges that you and I would face today. And He is still prepared this day for us. And He has ensured that we have the strength and the grace and the mercy that we need to make it through this day. May we pray together. Our Father, in Jesus' name, we thank you for the assurance that you are a God that has all things in your control. You're an omniscient God. You know everything. You're an omnipotent God. You have all power. And we thank you that you're an omnipresent God. You are everywhere. And so, Father, we thank you that you've gone with us through this day, knowing what we need and supplying all that we need. And for that, God, we say thank you. Thank you for the technology and the ability to be able to worship together online. And Father, we pray as we study the word, we pray that you would touch those that are grieving. We pray that you would touch those who are sick physically, those that are ailing emotionally and mentally. We pray for families that are hurting right now. We pray for people that are financially struggling. We pray for all of us that stand in need of your prayer, your blessings, your mercy, and your grace, that you would meet us at our point of need. And we pray, our Father, that you would forgive us of our sins. Take away those things that separate us from you and draw us closer to you. Save us, sanctify us, and strengthen us tonight through your word. These are your servants' prayers in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. On Sunday, we continued in our series of lessons about how to focus on the mission that God has for you. And Sunday, we looked at Matthew chapter number 4, verses 12 through 17. And in that, we saw Jesus leaving Nazareth, leaving his family and friends behind, even leaving his cousin John behind, who was in prison because of his righteous indignation at the terrible dealings of the king. And Jesus goes forward in his ministry and the mission that God has set out for him. In Matthew chapter 4, verse number 16, we find our lesson for tonight, or the verse that I want to dive deeper into and teach you about. The Bible says there, "The people who live in darkness have seen a great light, and for those living in the shadow land of death, light has dawned." Light has dawned. That's Matthew chapter 4, verse number 16. And for those that were waiting on it, let me put it in real quick. I love the Lord Jesus and I love his word. Join me in Matthew chapter 4, verse number 16. Tonight's deep dive out of Matthew chapter 4, verse 16 is titled "Light in Darkness." Light in darkness. The start of Jesus's ministry and his entry into Capernaum, where he would set up and launch out his ministry, is instructive because it's in this place that the light of the gospel and the light of Jesus's ministry starts out, and it is illuminated in a great way. Do understand this, that Jesus goes to Capernaum because he was not received in Nazareth, because he was the hometown boy, and he said a prophet is without honor in his own home. And so he takes the light that he is, not just that is in him, but he is the light that lights every man that comes into the world. And he comes into Capernaum, where it is a trade city. It's a larger, more bustling area in comparison to Nazareth. There are more people that come in and out of Capernaum. There are more Gentiles that are around in that area as they're going through on their trade. And it's in this place that is a great place for him to share the gospel that Jesus starts his ministry. And as Matthew writes here, he brings light in darkness. There are a couple of things that I want to extract from this text and help you understand some of the nuances of just how meaningful this particular passage of scripture is. The first thing is the darkness that's described. In verse 16a, the text says, "The people who live in darkness have seen a great light. They are living in darkness. What is the darkness that they're living in? It is not the absence of the sun shining, but it is the absence of God's glory and the absence of God's grace and the absence of God's blessing in this region because they have been under the veil of darkness for a long time, under curse, under chastisement by God, under the inhabitants of Rome, the habitation of Rome, meaning Rome has taken over this place. It's also in this place that many wars have been fought and battles have been fought. It's in this northern portion after the kingdom is divided into two halves. 10 tribes went to the north, 2 tribes go to the south. This area is in the northern portion of the kingdom that was most vulnerable because it was closest to Babylon, which is now modern day Iraq. And this place was invaded constantly and continually. And they have just been under wars and they have been under much great strain and stress. And they are in a period and a sense of darkness, not in the literal sense, but in the figurative sense. And friends, don't you know that we're living in a world today that is filled with darkness? In Psalm number 107, verses 10 through 14. Notice I numbered it Psalm number 107. I didn't say the 107th division of Psalm. There's no such thing as division. And I didn't say Psalm chapter 107. There are no chapters in the Psalms. It's just Psalm number 107, verses 10 through 14. The Bible says, "Others sat in darkness and gloom, prisoners in cruel chains, because they rebelled against God's commands and despised the counsel of the Most High. He broke their spirit with hard labor. They stumbled, and there was no one to help. Then they cried out to the Lord in their trouble. He saved them from their distress, and he brought them out of darkness and gloom and broke their chains apart." Friend, life without God is a life of darkness. There was an old country western singer, Hank Williams, who died very young, but he had a great song that he sang, "Praise the Lord, I saw the light. Now I'm so happy, no more sorrows inside. Praise the Lord, I saw the light." And when we come to Jesus and when Jesus comes into our lives, that's what happens. The darkness is driven away. The clouds of misery, doubt, depression, the clouds of uncertainty about our relationship and our standing with God are all dissipated because he dispels the darkness. As a matter of fact, Psalm 27 says, "The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear?" He dispels the darkness and the dark clouds that would come and arise in our lives. And this is his prophetical role. Isaiah talked about it. Micah talked about it. And then it is again declared in Luke that there is darkness that has pervaded, but God will take away the darkness that men live under. And friend, let me share this with you. If it seems that your light is dark, or that your life rather is dark, do know this, that there is a God, there is a Christ that has come to take away the darkness. But then number two, not only the darkness is described there, but in verse 16b, death is described there. It says in him, the people who live in darkness have seen a great light, and for those living in the shadows of death, in the shadows of death. Remember, this is a region that is often invaded. And so these people literally live looking over their shoulders. It's a place that has trade, but it's also a place where people will come in. Robbers and thieves will come in because they can slip in and out of town easily. You think about hotels that line up on the side of the highways and that stretch. Well, one of the things that they don't tell you is that those hotels that are right by highway entrances and exits are often subject to their parking lots have a lot of theft sometimes where people will break into cars. Why is that? Also stores that are right by the highways. Why? Because people will come in quickly and steal and be able to get on the highway and leave and go out very swiftly. That's the way it is in Capernaum. Also remember that they're closest to the Gentile world, and so they have been invaded often. And so they are constantly living under the threat of death. How terrible. How awful it is to live constantly looking over your shoulder and thinking about death that is all around. Well, friend, David experienced that when he said, "Yea, though I walk," in Psalm 23, "yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadows of death, I will fear no evil. He meant that death was all around. And in that particular psalm, it talks about a shepherd that's leading his sheep from one pasture land to the next. And often there would be those that would hide out in the clefts of the rocks in order that they may overcome the shepherd and steal away his sheep. And if not, people and murderers and all of those things that would be in the clefts of the rocks, then ravenous animals, wolves and coyotes and those types of things would be in the clefts and the hiding places of the rocks, looking down and seeing how they could come and ambush those that are going through the valley. And friend, don't you know our enemy, the devil, is going around like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour, and he is always looking to steal, kill, and destroy. But friend, though we walk through these valleys of the shadows of death, and death seems to be all around, every time you turn on the news report, do know this, that we have a God and we have a Christ that is always taking care. In Psalm 23, verse 4, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadows of death, I'll fear no evil. Psalm 44, verses 17 through 19, our heart is not turned back, neither have our steps declined from thy way. And though thou hast sore broken us in the place of the dragons and covered us with the shadow of death. There the psalmist talks about being under this constant threat. And friend, that's what this life gives you. It gives you nothing but death. But thank God that we have a Christ who brings life. So think about this. Darkness is all around and death is all around them. And here comes the dispeller of darkness and the dispenser of life. In verse 16c, he's talked about as the great light in verse 16, clause A. He's spoken of as the one that would take away the death, the shadows of death, because the dawn comes in. He's a great light that comes in and dispels that darkness. And here we look at the dawn. What does dawn mean? Dawn is a new beginning. Dawn is light that is coming in. Dawn, it means that though the shadows of death have loomed in the night watches, that God has spared us through the night, and now the dawn and the glory of the morning is coming. And that's what Jesus's ministry meant. They thought that he was going to reestablish the kingdom, but no, God was going to reestablish his rule in men's hearts and bring peace and joy back to their heart. John chapter 1 verse 9 says, that was the light which lights every man that comes into the world, speaking of Jesus. He is the light of this world. And then the memory verse that I wanted you to remember for this week is John chapter 1, verses 4 through 5. In him was life, and the life was the light of men, and the light shines in darkness, and the darkness comprehended or apprehended or stopped it not. There is no darkness that can ever stop the light of Christ's glory. In the Johnine writings, he pulls this idea of light and life. There are three great themes in John's writing. One is the Word, or Logos. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God. That's the Logos. Then the next word is life, or Zoe, not bio, from which we get our word biological sciences, meaning the study of life, but no, the essence of life is what John means when he says Zoe, and then light. In 1 John chapter number 1, John says, if you'll turn there, and that's our last scripture to look at, in 1 John chapter number 1, John picks up on this theme about Jesus being life and Jesus being light when he says, that which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we have looked upon, and our hands have handled of the word of life, the Logos of Zoe, and that life was revealed, and we have seen it, and we testify and declare unto you that eternal life that was with the Father and was revealed to us. What we have seen and heard, we declare unto you, that so that you may have fellowship along with us, and indeed our fellowship is with the Father and with the Son, Jesus Christ. We are writing these things so that your joy may be full. Friend, Jesus is the light. And if you go on further in verse number 5, now this then is the message which we have heard of him and declare unto you, that God is what? Light. That means the purity of God. That means the power of God. That means the essence of God. God is light. He is holy. He is righteous. And in him is no darkness at all. Friend, if your life is dark tonight, if there are shadows of death all around you tonight, I promise if you walk in the light of Jesus Christ, he'll take away the darkness and he'll give you his glorious light, but he'll also give you eternal life through him. God bless you. Have a great week and walk in victory.